I was fortunate enough to be invited to have a show at True West Gallery, 130 Lincoln Avenue in Santa Fe, and voila, here we are. It sort of is a spectrum of all different sorts of art that I've done over the years. And I can explain, people have asked me to explain what I'm doing and why. And why do I like nests? Because they're natural, they're full of hope for the future, they're full of fragile, delicate things that will turn into magical new things, scientifically magical. Science is magic, isn't it? And so I started to combine different things that would never be together in real life. Although birds do put lots of different things in their nests, they don't usually put barbed wire. And you wouldn't find a neat array of different sorts of feathers. A raven's feather, I think it's a gray jay feather, turkey feather, nuthatch feather, kestrel feather, and others. And then this little feather floating on the water. This one is called Becalmed. And when I was doing it, I felt becalmed and I wanted it to be calming. Up above is nested in an apple tree in front of a body of water, and just seemed to be a very tranquil place in the dawn light. And then we'll move down to Sage Moon. It's also called Mountain Nest. The nest is of a towhee, which is a bird which nests in northern Vermont, and it spends its winters, our winters, in Bolivia. And I find it fairly astonishing that the bird goes that immense distance, and that it has since ancient times. So here I put a fossil. I believe it's an ammonite. I have the fossil, and I worked from life with it. And then I put in wishstones and the moon and beautiful clouds. Down here, I had started to experiment with pouring glazes, thin washes of acrylic paint, and spattering things into them. And it was the cosmos in the distance. So I thought that the bird should be flying into the cosmos. And here we have the gramma grass, which lets its seeds go and then curls up into this incredibly graceful curve. And it's all over where I live here in New Mexico. This one is called Trajectories. And I was sort of fascinated by the fact that birds connect the world and they draw lines of migration in every direction, north, south, east, and west, around the circumarctic, I think it's called, around the Arctic areas. So that was what the ribbons were. They're the trajectories. And the peacock, I just wanted to put the most ridiculously beautiful things together. But it turned out to be amazingly painstaking. It took forever with very small brushes to get it right. Rogers Raven, or Yellowstone Raven, was a painting for a friend. And I took the photo, and this is cedar that's peeling, old cedar. The bird was actually sitting on a branch in Yellowstone. So that's why. Celestial sense of the nest floating in space, and these are little twists of yarn around it because birds do find yarn and hair and little tendrils of things to line the nest. Here I just was experimenting with a lovely color. It's a twilight nest. This is a nest of a marsh bird. You can see it's tying the cattails together, weaving them together. Another marsh bird, this is a black tern, which are a pretty limited bird. They nest near where I lived in Vermont for many years. Here, this one is called Hope Entwined 5. And it also is about that connection through the trajectories of migration. The nest is actually an oven bird, and an oven bird's nests are about our eggs are about this big. So I decided to exaggerate them and exaggerate their beauty. And I also found out that they nest in northern reaches of Vermont and New England and perhaps all across the country. I just know they are in Vermont. but they winter in South America. So I included items from South America. Here's an old Peruvian sol, which is the unit of currency there. And then I added a pot, a vessel from the jungle cultures. And this is from the coastline. There's a shorebird on it. It's a weaving from the highlands of Peru. And because I lived in northern Vermont and spent a lot of time in Central and South America as a child and as an adult as well, it was about the hope of connecting those places peacefully. This one was just an elongated nest, having fun with the colors and weaving things together, weaving the beautiful tendrils. I started to experiment with landscape. I always wanted to be a landscape painter because that would mean I could be outside, which is where I love to be, in the forest, in the fields. And so that is why I did these landscapes. This one is at Cañon de Chelly in Arizona. This one is at Santa Luis, which is part of Bandelier National Monument. If you look closely, you can see there are petroglyphs in this one. There's a sun dagger, which is a spiral, and there's a little cocopelli, which is the flute player. White-winged doves have recently, in the past decade, come north in their migration. Not in their migration, but because of global warming, they are now, their habitat is way north of where it used to be limited. And bighorn sheep, oh, they're just gorgeous. And the juxtaposition of contemporary and ancient, contemporary and ancient is a fascination that I've had my whole life. This is a desert mandala. It just sort of happened. It's an anomaly. If you come in close, it's got the moon and the sun and then midday and mid-morning, mid-afternoon, morning. If you come in close, you can see this is entrance to a kiva or perhaps a well. And the ladders can take you down. And it's surrounded by a coyote, a Harris hawk, a desert tortoise, a woodpecker, a jackrabbit, and a rattlesnake, and an elf owl that nests in Sahuaro. So it just was a ton of fun to do. And some people say it makes them dizzy to look at it. Up above is it's called Between Earth and Sky, and it is it's an imaginary landscape, a combination of many places that I love. And it was a challenge to create a plausible space, but I think I got it. Pretty okay with it. Over on the other wall are additional paintings. Here there are a few cactus blossoms and a raven on a cactus blossom and just a raven and small nest. Cactus blossoms are hard to paint because they're incredibly translucent. They're so pale and beautiful. And it's a challenge to paint, even with glazes and thin, thin layers of color. It's a challenge. These are giclées, which are archival prints of my work. Of older work, a saw-whet owl, which is a very tame, very small. This is about three times the size of the actual owl. And they're in the northern forest. I've had some wonderful experiences with them. And a mountain lion. This is an original, sunflowers, just a joyful moment in nature. Here we have some more ravens. A raven landed on a dead cholla, they're sort of these sculptures that are out in the desert in the arroyos around Santa Fe and all over Southwest. When the plant dies, all the green, fleshy skin goes away, and all you're left with is this hollow, textured bark. It's like a walking stick. And I was having a lot of fun working with adding these crinkly, crackled textures in the background. I find them really beautiful. Here's a raven
on a cedar branch that they twist in a really interesting way, and there are petroglyphs on them. Here's another owl. Burrowing owls are that's about twice the size of an actual burrowing owl. And they also are very curious. If you're looking at, if you're near where they live in the holes in the ground. And if you are near where they live, they'll hide, and then they'll pop up and look and see who you are and what you're doing and what you're thinking. And yes, they're really quite a fascinating bird. And I love rocks. They're so pretty, the texture of rocks. And it's sort of a balancing tower with a wide variety of rocks on it. And below we have the collector. The collector is a raven in an alcove in a cliff, and he's been collecting artifacts. They're shards of pottery and shells, which you would find in Puebloan ruins because they traded. They interacted with coastal tribes as well. And here's another balancing act. These ravens are on a large pile of rocks, a teetering pile of rocks. And this is called balancing act because if one of the ravens flies away, the other raven is going to tumble. So it also was a study in the texture and color of rocks, and I had fun with it. This was a painting that I did. It's called Lotus Nest. And this is the nest of a loggerhead shrike, which is a really interesting bird. Look it up. Google loggerhead shrike or just shrike. But this is actually a photo of one of their nests, and that is the color and texture and quantity of eggs that they lay. And this was for a museum show I was invited to be in Santa Barbara, California, at a museum called Lotus Land. Hence the lotuses. They're beautiful, a beautiful garden. Botanical gardens that surpasses any garden I've ever visited, with variety and all things. I took the challenge of making a mandala sort of pattern with corn. This is called corn dance, and as usual, I exaggerate the curliness of the husks and the texture and color of the Indian corn. It's really quite lovely. Here's a painting, actually this is a giclée, of a raven's nest. Their eggs are actually sort of a greenish color or the same tone of blue. So they're very interesting, and they line their nests with the fur of the carrion that they feed on. They like roadkill to eat, so they have a very cushy nest because it's lined with fur, luxurious fur. This is the nest of, I can't remember what it is, but I believe it's a kingfisher, because they dig a 5-foot hole in a cliff bank by the water, and they lay their nests way, way back in a chamber there. So, and people ask if I work from photographs, and here's a good example of the fact that I don't work from photographs. I do. I don't, because if I say, hey, Mr. Horny Toad, don't move, that's a perfect pose. He's not going to hang around. The same thing with the deer. If I ask him to hold still, he's probably going to bolt. So I do work from a lot of photographs. I put together compositions of combined photographs that I take, and I also have a son and four brothers who are fabulous photographers. So I use reference from them. These are clay pieces. My MFA, my master's degree, is in ceramic sculpture. So I have always worked in clay. These are a slab of clay rolled out and then lifted and pressed from behind. These are to make the curves, and then additions and stamps. And I think this is a piece of coral that I used to make that stamp. And then a little... this is a jimson weed blossom or a desert primrose. I'm not sure which I was thinking of, but they're canyon images. In the canyons, you'll find these little, in the Grand Canyon, in many canyons that have some water somewhere or deep enough shadows, you'll find fabulous plants, fabulous little magical hideaway, secret gardens. And
let's see, up here we have a mourning dove, and or I'm not sure if it's a, it's not a white-winged dove, but on a dead cedar, you can see the twisting bark of the cedar. And here we have Mr. Jack. It's called Desert Dawn. I love jackrabbits, as I said before. And this is Jimson weed, which is an exquisite and fragile flower that blooms at night. And it is, in the morning it wilts. This one, this blossom is beginning to wilt. And the desert is vast and the jackrabbits are wonderful. And I wanted it to be a dawn sky, so I have the wild clouds. And an interesting fact is that jackrabbits can run 45 miles an hour. And they also are food for coyotes, which can run 43 miles an hour. So does that make jackrabbits fast food for coyotes? Let's think about it. And then and here's another Jimson weed I'm pretty happy with. It has petroglyphs in the background and a single blossom. They're just a magical flower. And they're so, as I said, fragile, and they vanish. They're really special.